I would like to request Dr. Shagufta Shaheen, Head Department of English, and the conference director to formally welcome the guests and brief our esteemed audience about the Department of English.
Respected guests on the dais, participants, colleagues, students, and my dear friends, good morning. I welcome you to the fourth national conference being organized by the Department of English, MANUU. It is indeed a wonderful opportunity for all of us, as over the next 2 days, we are bound to have meaningful academic interactions. The paper presentations and ensuing discussions will most certainly occasion a sharing of knowledge, an exchange of views, and hopefully provide pointers to the direction in which our discourse needs to be channelized for meaningful academic contributions. Apart from revealing new dimensions to the subject under discussion, a conference is also an appropriate forum to seek reactions to and inputs about our current line of inquiry. We are bound to be enriched with fresh perspectives of fellow scholars. Apart from being enthused by the zeal in passing judgment on our work, the critical evaluation will either bring about an inspired course correction to our most boisterous expositions or result in our being additionally motivated in favor of our own argument. If the latter be the case, then the resultant vigorous and spirited defense will boost our confidence. In both instances, however, scholarship is bound to take another giant leap towards excellence. Over the next 2 days, there will also be an opportunity to make new friends, exchange ideas, and share concern with co-enthusiasts of language and literature. Now, a brief introduction to MANUU and to the Department of English is, I think, essential, especially for those of the participants who are visiting our university for the first time. The university was established by an Act of Parliament in 1998 with a mandate to promote, develop, and impart quality education in the Urdu language. The stress is on vocational and technical education in Urdu through both conventional and distant modes of education. An additional responsibility is the empowerment of women through education. The Department of English started functioning in 2004 with just 13 students. Very few people knew about the university, and even fewer were aware that there was a full-fledged Department of English in the Urdu University. Gradually, through hard work and determination, the university and the department gained popularity. We are now on par with other institutions, and our English department is comparable on grounds of academic excellence to any in the country. Research activities commenced in 2006 with just 3 MPhil students, and the PhD program started the next year with just 2 students. Today, the approved strength of our MA program is 50. We have an annual intake of 15 scholars in MPhil, and admission to the PhD program is restricted only by the limits imposed on individual scholars as to the maximum number of scholars that can be allotted to each. The department strives to adhere to the mandate of the university by ensuring due preference to Urdu-knowing students in the admission process. The selection of research topics is also, to the extent possible, focused on encouraging a comparative approach between English and Urdu. Scholars of the department have successfully investigated, through comparative studies, subjects ranging from detective fiction to poetry. I'm tempted here to cite a few of the notable achievements of the department scholar. The translated works of Ibn Safi are compared to the writings of Ian Fleming and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, and the poetry of Yeats with that of Faiz Ahmed Faiz. In a heartening display of empowerment of women through education, one student very convincingly defended her critique of Ghalib's poetry through a feministic analysis of his work. Apart from regular courses for its own scholars, the department is also entrusted with the responsibility of conducting English proficiency classes for all other students of the university with the objective of enhancing their employability. Recently, a bridge course is being designed to accommodate madrasa students, which will enable them to join the mainstream and be on par with the rest of the university's academic milieu. Students are also encouraged to organize and participate in cultural activities and have successfully staged several plays and Nukkad Nataks on contemporary issues. Here again, quite a few of the productions are related to issues of women. This is in consonance with the empowerment of women mandate of the university. The department also strives to bring focus and initiate meaningful debate on Maulana Abul Kalam Azad. His multifaceted personality as a national leader, journalist, educationist, freedom fighter, and scholar are the subject of a paper in the department's curriculum. This paper not only provides a platform to learn about Maulana Azad's myriad achievements, but also affords an opportunity to critically analyze his persona through the eyes of his contemporaries. The resultant of this approach, which encourages critical discussion, is carried forward by students in the creative expression. Not a year passes without informed writings, lively debates, and thought-provoking plays emerging as a result of this innovative paper option. Azad-inspired creative output has become an integral part of the repertoire of students at the literary and cultural events of MANUU. Options to choose between comparative, post-colonial, and recently introduced paper on Dalit literature provide ample opportunity for encouraging individual interests and sow the seeds of specialization. The department also ensures a balance between language and literature through a judicious share of each in terms of papers allocated in the semester. A constructive dialogue is encouraged among students with regard to language literature, Urdu, and Urdu English writers. The department also publishes a biannual journal to enable academic exchange, and the latest issue of MAJAL, that is Maulana Azad Journal of English Language and Literature, is scheduled for release shortly. It is a matter of great pride that our students are being admitted into research programs of various other universities in the country. They're also being placed in employment in the national and international level. I visualize a far more attractive future and the highest laurels for our students. It is my firm belief that exposure to such conferences will contribute immensely in further transforming the vision of MANUU into reality. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great privilege to introduce our keynote speaker, Professor Panchanan Mohanty. Professor Mohanty is presently the Dean's School of Humanities, University of Hyderabad. Professor Mohanty has specialization in applied linguistics. He has written and edited 20 books in English and Oriya. He's written over 100 scholarly papers on the subject, published in various reputed national and international journals. Professor Mohanty has held important positions in different linguistic associations. Besides being felicitated by various institutions, Professor Mohanty has been honored with the Pandit Gopinath Nanda Essay and Criticism Award in 2014. Professor Mohanty will be sharing with us today his scholarly insights on language, culture, and society in the Indian context. Professor Mohanty.
Good morning to you all. Chief Guest Professor Vishweshwar Rao, my former colleague Nasimuddin Saab, Head Dr. Shugupta Shaheen, Mr. Govindaya, who was our student, invited guests, colleagues, students, and ladies and gentlemen. It's a little accidental that I am delivering this talk today. We have been neighbors, University of Hyderabad and Maulana Azad National Urdu University, we have been neighbors for a few years. Though, you know, we come here and colleagues from MANUU go to University of Hyderabad, we don't have any collaborative kind of work. I would request both Nasimuddin Saab, because he was my colleague for quite long, and also Shugupta Ji, to take some interest so that we can work together, especially, you know, with reference to the Department of Englishes, we can work on English, we can work on Dakini. Dakini is something which is very important for all of us. And Dakini, nobody in the North will take much interest in Dakini. I'm saying there are some scholars from North India also. So it's our duty to work on Dakini and this variety of Hindi, all sorts of things we can do, language and literature we can talk about, and we'll definitely, I assure both Nasimuddin Saab and Sugupta Ji that we'll definitely like to collaborate and work on these things. And thank you all for this invitation, and all of us know, I have heard it many times that we are living in a postmodern world, especially in the academic institutions. I hear it very frequently, we are living in a postmodern world. When people use this kind of expression, what do you mean by the postmodern world? When we talk about postmodern world, we must know what is modern, what is pre-modern. Then only we can talk about postmodern world. There are many discussions, some of you know much better than I do, but I'll like to primarily discuss the linguistic postmodern world. Because today I'm going to talk about language, culture, and society. And being a teacher of linguistics, I would like to emphasize language and link it to society and culture. And since it's a conference on the English language, of course, I'll try to talk about how English is used in this country, in this multilingual country. Very briefly, a couple of points I would like to discuss. In the pre-modern India, or what we mean by pre-modern is something like this, from the language point of view. Languages are not standardized and codified. That was pre-modern world from the language point of view. And languages vary according to the geographical regions. And the social status of a speaker or a group of speakers will be emphasized, indicated, signaled by the use of a language. This is what we meant in the pre-modern world, so far as language use is concerned. The second point is that new languages are learnt for different purposes. Take, for example, all of us know why we learn English in this country, why we learn Hindi in this country. These things we know. When you come to the modern world, standard languages serve various communicative functions. That means a standard language, suppose you take Hindi in this country, Hindi should serve all the communicative functions that we have in this country. The best example should be, I should be able to write astrophysics or astronomy in Hindi. I'll ask this question to people present here. Can anybody write astrophysics and astronomy in Hindi today? Has Hindi been developed to such an extent that we can do it? That's what is done in Chinese, Japanese, Russian, French, Spanish, English. That's a different story. Hebrew. But can it be done in Hindi? Can it be done in Hindi? That's the question I'm asking. When you come to the other important aspect of the modern world is that monolingualism was emphasized. It's because most of the Western societies are monolingual, nations are monolingual. France, French, Spain, Spanish, something like that. But when you come to India, can we say Indian? Is it a language? When you say Bharat, is there a language like Bharati? So, you know, what I'm trying to emphasize here is that let's not take Western models and impose it on impose it on the Indian context. That's not going to work. We must think afresh. I see a lot of, you know, young people present here, and you are our future. I mean it. I'm not posing. You are our future, and mean it. And unless you start thinking afresh, many things won't happen. And the second important aspect of the modern world was that the so-called minor languages or regional languages were marginalized to a large extent. Okay, come to the postmodern world. Postmodern world emphasizes multilingualism. Anywhere, including France, which was predominantly monolingual, today talks about, you know, multilingualism and teaches English and certain other European languages. And when I said this to a French professor, she didn't believe. I said, go to BBC on this date, the news I have heard, on the YouTube, and try to find out whether it's true or not. Then she went, she visited and that site and told me, hey, it's happening in France also. I said, yes, the whole world is trying to be multilingual. And multilingualism should be the norm. When we are talking about multilingualism should be the norm, all of us know that India is a multilingual country. We know that. Now, what kind of multilingualism we have in India? I would try to, you know, give you some kind of the real face of Indian multilingualism. What I'll give you is the government data, 2001 census data. Nothing else. I may not agree with those data. But we'll have to believe in some data. I'll give you, let's say, a couple of instances first. Many of us do not know how many languages are spoken in this country. People sitting in this room are the most educated people in this country. And I'm sure most of you do not know how many languages are spoken in this country. I'm a little emphatic because I know what is happening in this country. Please don't take me amiss. Okay. Now, there are four major language families. Major language families. I don't say only four language families. Four major language families which are spoken in this country. Indo-Aryan, Dravidian, Austroasiatic, and Tibeto-Burmese. These are the four major families. According to census of India, no, four major families, I agree. But these nomenclatures, I don't agree. But that's a different issue. We will not discuss certain things. We will discuss only government data. Among the Indo-European, Indo-European languages, there are 24 languages. Please remember 24 languages. And the percentage of speakers is 76.86 in this country. 24 languages, and the percentage is 76.86%. Come to Dravidian, 17 languages, the percentage of speakers is 20.82. Okay? Now, if you put together, it is almost 97%. Almost 97%. Okay, come to Austroasiatic languages, 14 languages, and the percentage of speakers is 1.11. 14 languages and 1.1%. Come to Tibeto-Burmese, 66 languages. All the three families put together may not be 66. Tibeto-Burmese has 66 languages and only 1% speakers. Something happens, tsunami, some calamity, or these two families are completely, you know, wiped out, annihilated. Will India be multilingual? What multilingualism are we talking about? And for your information, most of the languages belonging to Austroasiatic and Tibeto-Burmese families are completely neglected in this country. And only among the Austroasiatic languages, only Santali is in the 8th schedule. That is only 10-12 years ago. And among the Tibeto-Burmese languages, Manipuri, Bodo, these two languages are part of the 8th schedule. Every other language is either Indo-European or Dravidian. This is one part of the story. The other part of the story is, again from the same census data, there are, as all of you know, there are 22 scheduled languages. And out of these 22 scheduled languages, Hindi is one, and many of you will be surprised to know that Hindi also has a dialect called Hindi. So the language name is Hindi. Under Hindi, there are 49 names which have been listed. And out of those 49 names, there is one name Hindi. So Hindi is also a dialect of Hindi. And 96.56% of speakers in this country speak these 22 scheduled languages. That means 96% of Indians speak these 22 scheduled languages. And only 3.44% speakers speak the remaining so many, you know, non-scheduled languages. So this is the multilingualism, this is the kind of multilingualism we have in this country. This is just to remind you that our multilingualism is at stake. That's the reason there is nothing else. Okay, now let's get back to what kind of bilingualism and trilingualism we have in this country. Okay. Hindi speakers are more than 42 crores according to 2001 census. More than 42 crores. And among them, only 2.13% are trilingual. That means 98% of the Hindi speakers do not know three languages. And we are talking about the three language formula for the last, you know, more than 50 years. Okay, come to Tamil, it is 3.19%. That means 97% of the Tamil speakers are not trilingual. Okay, I have other data on other languages. I won't give you the, those data. Take bilingualism figures. Bilingualism figures show that only 11.95% of the Hindi speakers are bilingual. That means 88% of the Hindi speakers are monolingual. Only 12% are bilingual, 11.95. So 88% of the Hindi speakers are monolingual. How can we expect others to be bilingual and trilingual? So this is the situation in this country, and I strongly believe this country must have a language policy. Unless there is a language policy, language planning, things won't happen. Okay, now let's get back to the second languages. And as you know, India, we were talking about first language and second language. Unfortunately, English is not an Indian language even today. How? It's not a part of these 22 scheduled languages. If something is not a part of the 22 scheduled languages, how will you say that it's an Indian language? It's not an Indian language. It's only the second official language of the country. The first official language is Hindi. Hindi is not the national language in this country. India, luckily, I'm emphasizing, luckily, it doesn't have a national language. I'm very fortunate that India doesn't have a national language, as it doesn't have a national religion. I'm quite happy that we don't have a national language. Now, Hindi is the first official language, and the second official language is English. It's a second official language, but not an Indian language. Had it been an Indian language, it should have been part of the 8th schedule. So this kind of problem is also there. I very strongly believe India, Indian English is an Indian language. I'll come back to Indian English. We have not talked about that as yet. Now, the importance of a language will be indicated by the number of second language speakers. How many speakers use it as a second language? And you will be very glad to know that there are not many languages in this world which are spoken by more second language speakers than the native speakers. Only handful, 5, 6, 7, 8, not even 10, I assure you. Look at the data or Google it, find from the net. Not even 10 languages are spoken more, the second language speakers are not more than the mother tongue speakers kind of thing. But luckily English, the mother tongue speakers of English is 331 million. It is only 2009 data. I have taken from the ethnologue data. 331 million speak English as a mother tongue, whereas 812 million speakers speak English as their second language. See, 331, 812, almost, 500 million more speakers as a second language speaker. Now, this is very, very important. And if you talk about English in India as a mother tongue, there are 2,26,449 mother tongue speakers in English according to the 2001 census. There are some people who claim that their mother tongue is English. That's something which you must remember. One point which I would like to mention here is that if you remember in Raja Rao's Kantapura, English is referred to as a language of Christianity. There are expressions where, English has been referred to as language of Christianity. And that's the reason for which late 19th century, many of our parents, Indian parents, never wanted their children to, join a school that was teaching English. But today, English is not a language of Christianity. It's a highly secular language. And look at Sanskrit, it was a secular language. Today, it's no more a secular language. Look at Urdu, it was a secular language. In fact, I have seen it till 1980, when I was a student at Delhi. I have seen all the elderly persons who are not Muslims, they used to read newspapers in Urdu. But today, Urdu is not considered a secular language. Things are changing, but I must sensitize, especially the younger people, that you should take note of all these things. Okay, now when we are talking about English in India, which English are we talking about? I know I have, sometimes I do evaluate dissertations on English language, not literature. And most of the times people refer to RP, the received pronunciation, always. In fact, about a year ago, there was a dissertation that I got from IFLU, and every time the student was referring to RP. This is something which happens in RP. This is what happens in Indian English. Then, I asked him, is there anybody in India who speaks RP? Nobody does that. So when the teachers themselves don't speak RP, we don't teach RP, how can we expect our students to learn RP and refer to that? That kind of problem is there. So it's and again, one more very important aspect, scholars from different parts of the world work on English, Indian English, more than the Indian scholars. This is something which is very astonishing, surprising. You will be surprised to know that if you take whatever work is being done on Indian English today, most of them are 95% of them, 90% of them are from other parts of the world, not India. We Indians are not working on Indian English. Okay, now, if somebody talks about RP, is okay. There was somebody called Daniel Jones and they talked about an estuary English. All these things were being discussed. But today, there are some recent works on RP. RP is always looked at as something that has a negative connotation, pompous, intimidating. These are the adjectives which have been used when people are asked to give their responses to RP. Not only students, educated people have used that. Oh, it's pompous. It's intimidating, that kind of thing. So RP doesn't have a positive connotation even in England today. So let's not talk about RP. There is another point here. Many of us believe that, in fact, this is, I have learned from different people who come to University of Hyderabad and other parts of the country, that if I come from a poor background and a rural background, my English will be bad. Poor background and poor and rural background contributes to poor knowledge in English. There is nothing like that. I have asked my students, fine, if you are poor and rural background, your English is bad. How about your Telugu? Telugu is fantastic. How about your Tamil? Fantastic. Odia? Fantastic. Bangla? Fantastic. How come poor and rural background doesn't contribute to your Tamil, Telugu, Odia kind of thing? It contributes to English? Because language is, everything happens in the brain, you know. The brain doesn't, it's not partial. Telugu should be learned properly, Urdu should be learned properly, Hindi should be learned, but not English. That's not true. There is something wrong in teaching methods, teaching materials, teacher training, etc., in English. That part is not, discussed. And I can, recently I presented a paper somewhere, it's called International Association of World Englishes. And the title of my paper was How I Learned English. What I did is that I went around Lingampally area. Lingampally, those of you who are from outside, Lingampally is almost, 7-8 kilometers from this place. It's, though there is Palli used, it is no more a Palli, it's no more a village, it's a part of Hyderabad city. And we went to 7 schools and I collected the students, 5, 6, 7 class students, English textbooks. Just wanted to see what they are doing. And believe me, everybody wrote the meanings in Telugu, not in English. Everybody on the margin, English textbooks, everybody wrote the meanings of English words, difficult English words in Telugu. That means the teacher is translating everything into Telugu. What is the teacher teaching, English or Telugu? That's the question we should ask. Here I should refer to an experiment that was conducted some time ago by Wong Filmo in Spain. She went and asked, this is a research report, she went and asked the teachers in a school, what is the method you use? No, it's a bilingual method. You use both English and Spanish in the English classroom. And the teachers said 50% English and 50% Spanish. And young Fulmer, being an intelligent researcher, she said, can I sit in your classroom and see what you are doing? They said, yes, welcome. Please do come and sit. Then she said, can I record how you are teaching so that it can be used in other parts of the world, something like that? So they agreed. And she went and sat in the class and got everything recorded. When she analyzed, 72% of the time was Spanish. Only 28% of the time was given to English. See, almost 1/4. Though they believed it is 50-50, number one. But it is not important. What is important is the next thing that I'm going to tell you. This 28% of the time, total allotted time, whenever the teacher was using English, students were unmindful. They were talking to each other, looking outside. The reason is that they knew that the same thing will be told to them in Spanish after a while. That means they were not listening to whatever the teacher was teaching in English. And if you don't listen to a language, you will not learn. So the teacher was practically teaching Spanish in the English class. I have not sat in these schools, whatever they were doing, but I assume something similar is also happening. As a result, the teacher is most probably teaching Telugu in the English class. Why should it be done? One must teach, if it is an English class, one must teach English. And she advised me, why don't you speak to them in English at home? And that's what you are advised. I am very sure you are advised as parents. You must speak to your children in English at home if you want them to learn English. There cannot be anything more, bizarre, you know, cannot be anything more bizarre than that. What I did is that being a linguist who works on language acquisition, language learning, I knew what I should do. And I never listened to whatever she said. And we spoke to our children only in Odia at home. But today I assure you, they speak better English than me, better Telugu than me, better Dakini than me, better Hindi than me. And their Odia is as good as mine. And what I'm trying to tell you is that there is a very strong argument in favor of making the mother tongue strong. In fact, there is a theory by a couple of people. One of them is Jim Cummins, who says that there is a theory called CUP, CUP. I'm saying CUP, it's easy to remember. Common Underlying Proficiency. He has argued that if a person's mother or a child's mother tongue is strong, the other tongue will be learned very easily because the first language, the second language will share the common underlying proficiency. That's the argument. He gives a whole lot of detail I didn't tell you. So that is very important. Now, what I'm trying to say is that if mother tongue is strong, other tongue will be acquired, learned very easily. So let's emphasize our mother tongue. And there is another theory which we have not heard in this country. If there is interference in acquisition of mother tongue, it's quite likely that the child will become semilingual, or in American English, semilingual, whatever way. I speak British English, so I prefer semilingual. Semilingual. Semilingual, since most of you know Hindi, semilingual will be translated as, if you ask me, I'll translate it as dhobi ka kutta. Na ghar ka, na ghat ka. That means the child's mother tongue will be bad and the other tongue will be bad. There will be a lot of, that means everything will be bad. So no interference. When we are teaching, let's say a child, eye, nose, ear, etc., when she is hardly 1.5 years or 2 years old, this is an interference. And I'll tell you how it is an interference. When you people speak your mother tongues, Hindi, Urdu, Telugu, Tamil, whatever it is. Do you ever use hand, eye, ear? Have you heard anybody saying, mera hand toot gaya? Since all of you know the word hand for, you know, so many years, now why are you not using mera hand toot gaya? Otherwise, or mera ear dukh raha hai, something like that. Do you use these things? No, never. Then why are you teaching these things to children? You know, it's a cognitive reason. The reason is cognitive. All of us are teaching our children all these things, but we don't use these words at all. So, you know, that means, that is the reason for which it's an interference. When I say that it's an interference from this point of view, it's a kind of interference. Okay? Now, if the mother tongue is strong, the other tongue will be learnt easily. As a result, the child will become a better bilingual, more fluent bilingual, additive bilingual, not subtractive bilingual. And additive bilingual makes a person cognitively much better, much stronger. Cognitive abilities will be more. There is another thing which I should tell you, that a person who knows more languages will have a longer life and healthier life. It's not a story I'm telling you. There is a person called Ellen Bialystok. She's one of the very well-known, you know, psycholinguists of the world. She was working on a project on the advent of dementia among the North Americans. And this is only 3-4 years old, not long ago. And, you know, there are Americans who are monolingual, who speak only English. And there are Americans who are bilingual, speak Spanish at home, English outside, Mexican at home, English outside. And she found that among the monolingual Americans, they were affected by dementia at the age of 71. She has something, 71 point something. I am ignoring that. And the bilingual Americans, 71, remember. But the bilinguals were affected by dementia at the age of 75. So 4 years of healthy life, if you know, another, everything else was matched. Not that one was from the poor background, one was from the rich background. No, not that kind of thing. Everything else was matched. Only difference was some people were, well, the one group was monolingual, the other group was bilingual. So bilingualism is very important for the Western world. For us, it should be, for India, it should be multilingualism, okay? There is another important issue. It's creativity and humor is on decline among children all over the world. And this is primarily because of neglect of their mother tongues. Now, because all of us know that creativity and humor, these things can be much better expressed in the mother tongue, not in other tongue. You can understand a humor better, joke better in other tongues. Since you are talking about creativity, I'll give you just one example. That is Professor Ivan Anantamurthy, one of the best professors of English in this country, who wrote only in Kannada, never in English. And I can give you another example from Odisha, Gyanpith Award winner, Gopinath Mohanty. He had an English degree. He wrote only in Odia, never in English. This has happened, you know. Many people don't write in English because they think they can express themselves better in their mother tongues, not in English. Okay, now since you are talking about English, what kind of English? I strongly believe it should not be RP, something like it. It should be Indian English. When you talk about Indian English, of course, which variety of Indian English? Because Telugu English, Bengali English, Tinglish, Binglish, all these things, Hinglish, all these jokes we have heard. Now, it's time we started talking to each other and talked about Indian English. Indian English phonology, Indian English morphology, Indian English syntax won't be very different, but some expressions here and there, we must work them out and start working. And if we are talking about these things, then only something we can do for this country. And another point which is quite crucial is that when we are preparing textbooks, we have not worked out what kind of English syntax and vocabulary should be used when we are working on a textbook for class 4, class 5, class 6, class 8, class 10, etc. This has never been worked out. Because whatever textbooks we are writing or the lessons we are writing, they must be age appropriate. Now, do you have English dictionaries for primary students? Do you have English dictionaries for secondary students? The same, I mean, the small pocket dictionaries are not dictionaries for children. They are only, you know, smaller dictionaries. They are all adult dictionaries. So these things have not been worked out. These are the areas which are quite important. Now, let's come back to, I'll only briefly discuss culture and language, and then, of course, I'll wind up. Okay, there are some very interesting things that I would like to mention. English people used to eat only berries. Never fruits. B-E-R-R-I-E-S, never fruits. Except apple, most of the names of the fruits in English are not Germanic. Because English is a Germanic language. French is not Germanic. It is another family. Subfamily, I'm sorry. They are cousins, not sisters. German and English are sister languages, but French and English are cousins, not sisters. You will see that most of the names of the fruits are French, except apple. All berries are native to English, but not the fruits. That means when these French speakers went and settled down in England in some 1,000 years ago, they introduced the fruits. They took the fruits and other things. So that's how the things have. Forget that. Here, those of you who think that mango is an English word, it's not. It's an Indian word. Mangai in Tamil, mamadikai, and all these things. This is mangai, very clearly. It has gone from India. Jackfruit has gone from India. That way English is quite liberal. You know, English knows that it can borrow a word from other languages and won't have to give back anything. If I borrow money, I'll have to give you back. But if you borrow words, you won't have to give back. English is very liberal. As a result, it has become a rich language. What I'm trying to hint at is that some people are talking about purity of languages. It's an absurd concept. Nobody is pure culturally and biologically also in this country. So let's not talk about purity of languages. Okay? Another important, interesting information is that words like sheep, pig, and cow, they are all English. Germanic. English means Germanic. But their meat, that is mutton, pork, and beef, they are all French. That means the English people were raising these animals and the French people were eating these animals. This shows their social status, because the French were the rulers, English people were the subjects, hence this kind of distinction. Okay? You take house. Wall, tile, mortar, kitchen, they are all from Latin. They are French. You take words like thatch, timber, huddle, wicker, they are all Germanic. That means, you can take even these words and discuss how a language has developed over a period of time. And for another, those of you who are interested in this kind of work, let me tell you that Sanskrit gum and English kum are from the same source. Gum can easily become kum in English. There is no problem. Though there is a semantic difference. Semantic difference is not a problem. Because another word I'll give you, because I have worked in the Arab world, bakra doesn't mean, bakra is an Arabic word, and it doesn't mean goat in Arabic. It means cow, it means, camel in Arabic, cow in Arabic. But when it comes to India, the meaning changes because of the social context. So this kind of thing is quite crucial and important, and I would request all of you to look at all these things and, discuss. Probably, especially the young, primarily, I'm very happy that a lot of young scholars are there, and these are some of the avenues which I have tried to discover, and thank you very much for this opportunity. I thank the organizers for this opportunity. So thank you very much.